Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Seven Deadlies by Theophilus Monroe and Michael Anderle, narrated by Rebecca Mitchell. Chapter 1. I opened the door and allowed the movers to bring in another red velvet couch. It was the fifth piece of unnecessarily luxurious furniture delivered this week, and it was only Monday. You'd think after seven demons escaped hell and had designs on wreaking havoc on Earth, we'd have better things to do to occupy our time other than fancy up the old schoolhouse that now served as our secret base. The problem was that when you're hunting things that sow the seeds of so many popular vices, it was a lot like finding a needle in a stack of needles. Pride, greed, lust, envy, sloth, gluttony, and wrath. Those were the seven deadlies. Not just sins, but demons who had a hankering for spreading their chosen vice to the extreme. All of the above could be found any night on Bourbon Street, not to mention thousands of other places all around the world. In the 3 months that had passed since we'd defeated Samuel Van Helsing after he'd tricked us into opening a hellgate that released the demons, nothing had turned up that was so far beyond the ordinary that it raised any definite red flags. We even had two of the best hunters I'd ever encountered, Alexander and Reginald Van Helsing, working with us to track them down. It was an odd relationship, especially given that they'd tried to kill Dracula and me more than once. They'd taken more than a fair share of shots at Dylan, my werewolf boyfriend, and his pack. It was in large part due to them that the pack was down to three wolves, Dylan, Logan, and Ian. We hadn't seen the Van Helsing brothers in more than a week, but they kept me updated by text message. So far, they were turning up nothing more than we were. It was probably for the best. My friend Zoey Grimm, the Grim Reaper's sister and the only Reaper who specialized in harvesting supernaturals, had recently given birth to her firstborn. Baby Josephine was doing great. With a newborn in the house, Zoey had bigger things to worry about. Still, when the demons finally came out of hiding, she was prepared to join us to take them down. As for Dracula, he'd turned his energies to sprucing up the headquarters. He even bought an old pipe organ from a local Catholic church that had just replaced theirs, and he had it installed in the old gymnasium. He played the thing constantly, most often Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor. Why? Because Dracula was a living, breathing, blood-sucking cliché. I knew the tune, even if I didn't know what it was called until Dracula enlightened me. The damn song was featured on the soundtrack of pretty much every old-school horror flick ever made. Dracula was the embodiment of every corny vampire stereotype out there. He insisted that he wasn't a cliché, but a trendsetter. Why was it his fault that his mannerism and behaviors were so often mimicked? There was a lot about Dracula that the movies missed, though. He was an aspiring comedian. His jokes were pretty bad. Even most dads would groan in response. He had a lot more humanity left within him than one would think for a vampire of his age. He could be terrifying if he wanted to be, but that wasn't his everyday persona, especially not for people he liked, such as yours truly. Movie villains just aren't realistic. It takes too much energy to act maniacal 24/7. Now that Dracula no longer had the dark power of the Scholomance within him, courtesy of the Weird Sisters, who'd hijacked his former power and replaced it with the Path of Light, dare I say he was actually a really good dude. His heart didn't beat more than a couple of thumps per minute, but his heart was bigger and stronger than one would think. While Dracula was playing creepy organ music and coming up with terrible puns, I spent most of my time in front of three computer monitors. The Van Helsing said I should look for certain telltale signs: cattle mutilations, an uptick in cult activity, including human sacrifices, and diseased crops. I made a simple program with an algorithm that scanned the internet looking for all those things. It searched news sites, message boards, and posts on social media. The algorithm still needed some fine-tuning. At first, it turned up so many hits that sorting through them all was a full-time job. I had to narrow it down. Then I narrowed it down too much and wasn't picking up anything. Now the algorithm gave me a series of prioritized results. Those that picked up multiple concurrent signs in a single geographic area were filtered into a folder I labeled High Priority. The rest went into a bulk folder I could search later. A few cattle mutilations could easily go undetected. Most ranchers probably assumed wolves or animals were responsible and didn't report it. My algorithm couldn't pick up stuff that wasn't somewhere online either. If there were ritual human sacrifices going on, they'd hit the internet as missing person reports first. Zoey's fiancé, Kevin, a detective in Kansas City, was digging into any suspicious missing person cases since my algorithm couldn't access police files. So far, he had found nothing definitive. It was a matter of time. The Van Helsings were a lot older than they looked. They were the sons of Abraham Van Helsing, the same Van Helsing from the stories about Dracula, and they'd stayed alive for years using an immortality elixir. They'd hunted demons before. In nearly every instance, the demons they'd dealt with possessed human hosts. They needed hosts to unleash their nastiness on the world. They also tended to start small and try to mimic the behaviors and personalities of their hosts so they could blend in and wait for an opportunity to maximize the havoc they unleashed on the world. Chances were good that once the Seven Deadlies started their shit, we'd know it. My algorithms wouldn't be necessary. Still, most of the signs the Van Helsing said I should look for might give us an early warning about where the demons were. If we could pinpoint their locations and get to them before they did their worst, we could save lives. I had new powers that I could use to stop the demons in their tracks. With the abilities I'd gained from the Scholomance, the lunar abilities that brought the former paths of light and darkness together as one, I was the perfect soldier in a war against demons. The problem? If I used those abilities to fight the demons, I'd strengthen the Babylonian god Sin, who'd used his wife, the priestess Enigaldi, to vest me with the power. From what I'd learned, Enigaldi created the first vampire thousands of years ago for that very reason, to save the world from demons. Now that I embodied the lunar path and could create more vampires like me, Enigaldi wanted me to lead the charge, purge the world of the demons, and give her hubby all the power he needed to gain the strength to rival the other gods and return to Earth. The ghost of Abraham Van Helsing spilled the beans before the Reapers took him to the afterlife. I wasn't supposed to know the truth, but I did. Now we had to find a way to locate and defeat the Seven Deadlies that didn't require the use of my lunar abilities. That didn't mean I couldn't use my newfound skills at all. They could still come in handy tracking down the Seven Deadlies or fighting off any cultists or anyone else who got in our way. I just couldn't kill demons that way. Not unless I had no other choice. If it came down to letting the demons murder thousands of people and risking giving Sin a little extra juice, well, I'd fought a few gods in the past and won. That was a risk I'd have to take. Still, if I could avoid creating a mega god who had designs on subjecting humanity to his will, I had to try. I was sitting at my computer, examining the latest questionable hits turned up by my algorithm when I felt two strong hands on my shoulders. I closed my eyes for a moment as Dylan massaged my traps. "Don't stop. You have a lot of tension." I chuckled. "Yeah, well, when you have the weight of the world on your shoulders, a little tension is to be expected."
"You don't have to carry this alone. We're all behind you.
Even the Van Helsings have set aside their personal vendettas to help. Let the rest of us handle some of the burden. I sighed. I wish I knew what these damned demons were up to. How can I stop them if I can't find them? You realize if this is going to work, you might not be the one who has to stop them, right? I can't zap them with my moon power. That doesn't mean I can't stop them. How do you plan to do that? Call up Zoey? I nodded. That, and splash them with holy water. The Van Helsing said they don't like that shit. Dylan laughed. I don't like sweet tea. Splashing me with it won't kill me. I tilted my head. Not right away, but too much sugar will do you in eventually. And if there's any artificial sweetener in it, well, you're just asking for an early grave. Artificial sweeteners aren't that bad. You'd have to drink way more than most people could to really notice any negative side effects. I doubt it would hurt me anyway, unless they developed an artificial sweetener derived from silver. I rolled my eyes. You're missing the point. It doesn't matter, Sienna. What I'm trying to say is that, short of using your lunar powers, we all have just as good a chance as you do to destroy these things. We all have just as much at stake. Zoey can do it. She'll come help when the time comes. I still have to find the bastards first. Dylan kissed me on the cheek. Did you notice it got quiet? I tilted my head. Dracula finally stopped playing that damn Bach number. Right on cue, Dracula started shouting from somewhere down the hall. God damn, bloody hell, son of a bitch. I stood, chuckling. What in the world had Dracula done now? Dylan followed me out of my room and into the hall. Dracula was stomping up and down outside of the men's room, pulling at his own hair. Drac, what's going on? Dracula stopped pacing and placed his hands on his hips. I did it again. I narrowed my eyes. What did you do? I dropped my phone in the toilet. I had to place my hand over my mouth to stop myself from laughing. You've had a phone for 2 weeks, and this is the third time.
I know. You don't have to tell me that.
I know you're new to all this social media stuff, Drac. You really don't have to check your feeds while you're peeing. It can wait.
I wasn't peeing.
Dylan tilted his head.
Then how did you manage to drop your phone in the john?
Dracula snorted. His face actually colored a little, which for a vampire as pale as Dracula was hard to miss.
I was wiping.
You were using your phone while wiping your ass? The corners of my mouth were tense. It was all I could do to stop myself from busting a gut. Vampires don't have to go to the restroom nearly as often as humans unless we're indulging in human food. The problem was, if we did eat human food, our bodies didn't need it. That meant all of it turned to waste. It wasn't pretty, but Dracula had an appreciation for the finer things of undead life. That included gourmet meals. Even so, he hadn't overdone it until recently. Perhaps, given that we were currently in wait-and-see mode regarding the Seven Deadlies, a little extra grub here and there was a way to pass the time. To pass a whole lot of something else, anyway. Did you reach in and grab it? Dracula shook his head.
I'm not sticking my hand in that.
Isn't your phone water-resistant? Dylan asked.
Of course it is, Dracula snapped. But the smell won't come out. I need a new phone.
I rolled my eyes. I'll place the order. It should be here tomorrow or the next day. Dylan cleared his throat.
Someone still has to get the phone out of the toilet. I'm sure as hell not going to do it.
Dracula huffed.
I'll fish it out with the plunger. I'll leave the rest to the cleaning service.
I forced my lips into a close-mouthed smile. Good luck with that. Dylan followed me back into my room. We both started laughing, hard. It was the kind of laughter that was hard to quit. I forced myself to take a series of deep breaths until the chuckles subsided. What are we going to do with him? Dylan shook his head. You're the one who had the bright idea to sign him up on Facebook. I shook my head. I know social media can be addictive, but damn. Dylan smirked. That vampire is a glutton for punishment. I tilted my head. What did you just say? You'd think he'd learn his lesson after dropping his phone in the toilet twice. Everything with him has been done in excess lately. Playing his organ, eating too much food, using his phone. He's a glutton for punishment. I rubbed my brow. Surely not. I mean, what would be the chances?
I'm not sure I'm following you right now.
Gluttony is one of the seven deadlies.
Come to think of it, I've been more peckish than usual lately.
I bit my lip. I feel fine. I'm probably overthinking it.
Maybe not.
Dylan sat on the edge of my bed.
It's not just food. Anything I like, I've had a subtle urge to indulge in it more and more.
I chuckled. That certainly explains the uptick in your libido the last few days.
Dylan smirked. I blame you for that, not a demon. You're too damn hot to resist.
I grinned. I appreciate the compliment. But what if it's more than that? We know the demons start small and sow their seeds of vice gradually. It's worth looking into.
You might be immune to it. The lunar power is supposed to make you the perfect warrior to fight these demons. It makes sense their usual methods wouldn't work on you.
I narrowed my eyes. If this is gluttony, Dracula won't be the only one impacted by it. Let's take a little walk. If the seeds of gluttony are already sown, there's no place where it will be more obvious than on Bourbon Street. Chapter 2. It was about a 30-minute walk from the schoolhouse to Bourbon Street. It was only 10 o'clock in the morning. Not exactly the busiest time at New Orleans' most popular tourist attraction. Most of the partiers from the night before were still hungover and sleeping off their previous night's episode of drinking and debauchery. That was the typical pattern, anyway. When we arrived on Bourbon Street, you'd think it was the middle of Mardi Gras, not what one would expect for a Monday morning. Hardly a single person was walking straight. We ducked into one of the popular Creole restaurants, and it was packed to the gills. The first man I spotted was clutching at his gut. He was stuffed full, but he was placing an order for three more entrees. Every table in the place was full of food, more than anyone could reasonably consume in a single sitting. Two or three pitchers of beer and pretty much every dessert the restaurant served were also squeezed onto the small tables. The looks on the patrons' faces resembled mine after a Thanksgiving meal, back when I was a human and still ate my fill on the holiday. They were still shoveling food in their mouths, chasing it with beer, and didn't appear to be ready to stop anytime soon. I shook my head. Gluttony. It has to be.
This is worse than I thought. This makes Dracula's symptoms seem minor.
He's a vampire. You're a werewolf. Maybe the effects of the demon's vice don't strike supernaturals as fast. Dylan and I stepped out of the restaurant. He scratched the back of his head.
Is it possible to eat oneself to death?
I'm no medical expert, but it's basic physics. The stomach can only stretch so far. The body can only digest food so fast. Add ungodly quantities of alcohol and...
Dylan nodded.
Drinking oneself to death is certainly possible.
I clenched my teeth. If this is gluttony, just imagine what the other demons might be able to do. Any vice pushed to the extreme like this could be deadly. Wrath, for instance.
What about lust? Dylan asked. Imagine an entire city consumed by it. I'm not sure how deadly it would be, but it would be chaotic.
Combine lust with envy, add a dose of wrath, and you'd have a recipe for slaughter. I doubt this is a localized problem. Maybe gluttony put down his roots here, but the problem will spread. Eventually, the influence of the various demons will overlap. This is more than a few vices running amok. We may be looking at a mass extinction event. The demons escaped hell through a portal here in New Orleans. If the other six deadlies went elsewhere, they might be lagging behind. I shook my head. Not necessarily. It's been 3 months. What if gluttony was waiting until all the other demons were in place, wherever they intended to sow their first seeds? This could be starting elsewhere at the same time.
It shouldn't be long before your algorithms pick things up then. If Sloth takes root somewhere, maybe an entire city decides not to show up for work.
We're guessing at this point. I have no idea what it would look like for pride or envy to manifest. Those vices aren't as easy to define.
Pride can take many forms. People can envy one another for any number of reasons.
Those demons might be harder to track than gluttony, sloth, and certainly lust.
Any word from the Van Helsings?
I checked my phone. Nothing yet. I'll shoot Alexander a text. I stepped back into the Creole restaurant and took a quick photo. I attached it to a text message to Alexander. Pretty sure gluttony is in New Orleans. Advise? The three dots that appeared on my screen suggested that Alexander was typing out a reply. It showed up a few seconds later.
You're right. Meet us at St. Louis Cemetery No. 1. The demons can't infiltrate consecrated ground.
I huffed. They must be in the area. So much for keeping us updated. They're already on it.
Dylan glanced over my shoulder and looked at the text. What the hell is consecrated ground?
I shrugged. My guess is that it includes places blessed by clerics, some cemeteries and churches. Not sure why that works, but if there are a few safe havens from demonic attack, we may be able to use consecrated ground for triage.
Dylan scratched the back of his head. You saw everything I did. There's no way we're packing all those people into cemeteries.
If we don't do it now, they'll end up there later, I pointed out. I know it's a grim thought, but it's the truth.
This might be impacting thousands more people outside Bourbon Street. Evacuating people from the city might be a more viable option.
How exactly are we going to convince people to do that? Besides, that doesn't stop gluttony. He'll follow them. Or worse, he'll move to another city and we'll be back to square one, waiting for signs. Let's hope the Van Helsings have thoughts on tracking the bastards down so we can end this.
It wasn't a long walk to St. Louis Cemetery No. 1. I was still relatively new to the area, but the cemetery was famous. It was the final resting place of the renowned voodoo queen, Marie Laveau. Civil rights pioneer Homer Plessy was buried there. Nicolas Cage's tomb was there, too. Not dead yet. The tomb looked like the pyramid from National Treasure. He must have either thought the movie was going to kill his career, or he loved it so much he wanted to rest in it forever. Talk about planning for the future. The Van Helsing brothers were waiting for us, along with a short, rotund, bald priest just inside the cemetery gates. The cemetery wasn't open to the public. Most of New Orleans' dead were buried in above-ground tombs, vaults, and mausoleums, a necessity due to the city being at or below sea level.
The priest opened the gate to let us through. Alexander nodded at me.
Sienna, Dylan, this is Father Albert Lyons.
I shook his hand. He winced when he touched mine. I was a vampire, cold to the touch. His reaction wasn't unexpected.
I'd say it's a pleasure to meet you, but these aren't exactly pleasurable circumstances.
Father Albert nodded. He pulled his hand from mine and reached toward Dylan. Dylan shook the priest's hand.
Hey, hey, hey!
I elbowed Dylan in the ribs. The priest sighed.
Fat Albert jokes. Hardly original, son.
Dylan diverted his eyes away from the priest.
Sorry.
The priest smirked.
I prefer blessedly rotund Albert. Much more PC.
I chuckled. The joke eased Dylan's momentary regret and smoothed the pain he must have felt in his jaws after shoving his left foot into his mouth. The priest led us through the gate and locked it again behind us.
These are unusual circumstances. I'd not typically welcome a vampire on consecrated ground, but the brothers here are vouching for you.
I glanced at Alexander and Reginald.
You two vouched for me? Seriously?
Alexander cleared his throat.
You helped our father rest in peace.
Dylan grunted.
And you murdered most of my pack.
Alexander shook his head.
We share a common enemy. I think it would behoove all of us to set aside our former vendettas.
Bygones and whatnot, I added. Dylan nodded.
You're right. Given what we're facing, I'll do my best to keep my resentments to myself.
Reginald grinned.
Likewise.
You also killed our brother, James.
Don't forget Samuel. Killed him, too.
Alexander nodded.
Samuel got what was coming to him. The point is that we recognize this is an unlikely alliance. There's too much at stake. No offense, Sienna. To allow any grudges we might hold to get in the way of doing what must be done.
I smirked. Too much at stake. You've got vampire jokes now.
Correction.
Alexander pinched his chin.
Vampire hunter jokes. I suppose stakes aren't nearly so humorous from your perspective.
I grinned. Ever hear about the vampire who went vegan?
I haven't, Alexander said. Is that really a thing?
I smiled widely. It was a big missed stake. Reginald groaned.
I see what you did there. Doesn't make sense, though. Vampires don't eat steak.
Do you know why Robert Pattinson was the worst vampire ever?
Reginald grunted.
Twilight?
Seriously, Sienna?
Tell me why.
Because it took him 15 years to turn into a bat.
You should leave the jokes to Dracula.
Did you hear about the vampire who fed exclusively on wizards?
Alexander sighed.
No, but I assume you're about to tell us all about it.
He was a necromancer. The brothers stared at me blankly.
Surely we have more to discuss than bad vampire jokes.
Of course. I already told you in my text. We think Gluttony might be in town.
Gluttony is always in town, Father Albert said. But you're right. The demon is here. We've been tracking him for a while, Alexander explained. We knew at least one of the demons remained in the area, but we weren't sure which one until now.
There have been signs of a demon's presence, I asked. Reginald glanced past me through the gates.
Notice anything else unusual?
I shook my head. You mean other than people stuffing their faces beyond what's natural?
Look at the grass and trees. It's all withering.
I shrugged. Maybe it needs water. Reginald shook his head. It rained yesterday, and the day before that. It's subtle now, but where these demons go, something about their presence affects the plant life. Father Albert cleared his throat.
It's often a delayed effect, sort of like Roundup. If a demon is around, the plants will slowly die over the next several days.
I rubbed my brow. By the time plants start withering and dying, then, the demon might be long gone.
Very true, Reginald admitted. The good news, though, is that so far the problem hasn't spread far beyond the French Quarter.
How fast could Gluttony spread his vice, I asked. Father Albert tugged at his collar.
Not as fast as you'd think. The demon must make physical contact with someone to sow the vice in someone's soul. Given the number of people affected in the area, there's reason to believe he's active here presently.
Dylan tilted his head.
We think Dracula might be infected. He's shown a few symptoms, albeit not as extreme as the cases on Bourbon Street. Vampires can fight off the impact of the demon's touch, Alexander said. His symptoms should subside in a couple days.
I cocked my head. That means whoever this demon is possessing must have come into contact with Dracula at some point over the last 2 days. He doesn't get out that much. We might be able to narrow it down.
Possibly, the priest said. The demon can move from host to host. If Gluttony no longer possesses whoever passed the vice to Dracula, tracking down whoever he came into contact with might be a dead end. It's a start, Alexander said. We can use that. Anyone who has been possessed will have symptoms and may have some insight into the demon's plans. That's right, Father Albert added. Most people possessed by demons remember the entire experience. While possessed, a host's body is protected from the more devastating effects of the demon's work. When the demon leaves, however, he might not have long to live if he's not brought to consecrated ground. The demon will leave behind a much stronger version of its particular vice than it normally spreads to others.
I took a deep breath. So, when you said that this host might be a dead end, you were speaking literally.
Alexander nodded. Possibly. It's still worth looking into. If we can narrow down whoever Dracula has come into contact with in the last couple of days, and we can reach the demon's host in time, even if the demon is gone, he might have useful information.
Dylan pursed his lips.
Has Dracula even left the schoolhouse the last few days?
I shook my head. I don't think so. There have been a few people in the schoolhouse. Dracula has ordered a few pieces of furniture. Most of the pieces were delivered by the same crew.
We need to speak to Dracula, Alexander said. Can you give him a call?
I grimaced. About that. Yeah. His phone isn't currently in operation.
Dylan chuckled. It went to shit. Literally.
Alexander narrowed his eyes. He didn't know what Dylan was talking about, and I wasn't going to waste time telling the story.
We still need to speak to him. Whichever one of these movers might have been possessed at the time had to touch Dracula to pass on the vice. Dracula didn't feed on any of the movers by chance, did he?
I huffed. He did not. Contrary to popular belief, Drac isn't a monster. Not anymore. He only drinks bottled blood these days.
Alexander nudged the priest. Come along with us, Father Albert?
Albert nodded.
Allow me to gather a few supplies.
Supplies? I raised one eyebrow.
A few items necessary for an exorcism, just in case. You can't be too prepared.
Chapter 3. I wasn't sure what went into an exorcism kit. Holy water, most likely,
Probably a crucifix or two, a book of rituals, and a few sanitary wipes. I've seen The Exorcist. If the real thing was anything close to that, it was sure to get messy. That film was the sole reason I always refused to eat pea soup whenever my mother served it up for dinner. It wasn't like I was an expert on ecclesiastical wares. The priest probably had a few relics or whatever I didn't know about. Then again, how many exorcisms could he have possibly performed before? Surely actual demon possession wasn't all that common. There was also no reason to believe that the priest, of all the clerics the Roman Catholic Church might appoint to such a task, had a ton of experience doing this sort of thing. My plan, if we encountered the demon, was to call Zoey and see if we could get Morty to bring her to New Orleans by way of a Reaper portal. If these demons really could jump bodies, though, we might not have enough time to pull that off if we cornered Gluttony in a host. Then again, what good would an exorcism do? Casting out a demon wouldn't help in the long run if Gluttony just found his way to another host. We had just left the cemetery when the sound of screeching tires and a honking horn from behind startled all five of us. We had to dive off the sidewalk to avoid getting hit by an incoming sedan. The car crashed into a tree, and I ran over to check on the driver. He was bleeding from his brow, which immediately stoked my hunger. My cravings were nothing compared to his, though. Even as the blood dripped from his brow, he was forcing an ice cream cone into his mouth. He had several styrofoam containers of food all over the front of his car. He also reeked of beer.
"Is he all right?" Father Albert asked.
I shook my head. "Define all right."
"Is he seriously injured?"
"Took a blow to the head, it appears. Other than that, nothing that looks life-threatening from what I can tell." Alexander sighed.
"We have to keep moving. Things are getting worse by the minute."
No sooner did Alexander say that than another car crashed into a fire hydrant on the opposite side of the road. The hydrant turned into a geyser.
"What a nightmare," Dylan exclaimed.
"They can't stop eating, not even to drive. This is insane." Father Albert put his hand on my back.
"Alexander is right. Things are only going to get worse if we don't find Gluttony soon."
We witnessed three more wrecks on the way to the school. The further we got from the French Quarter, though, the more normal things were. Gluttony had ventured beyond Bourbon Street if he'd made an effort to infect Dracula. It made me wonder, why Dracula? Surely the demon knew his power wouldn't affect vampires to the same degree. Then again, so long as Dracula was fighting off his urges to overindulge in everything from playing the organ to social media, he wasn't as effective an ally as he was under normal circumstances. If it took a couple of days before he was back in fighting shape, there was no telling what sort of hell New Orleans could devolve into by that point. The front doors of the schoolhouse were wide open when we arrived. I turned to Dylan. "You closed the doors behind us when we left, right?" Dylan nodded.
"Locked up as well. I'm sure of it."
I took a deep breath. If Dracula left the schoolhouse, he could get himself into a lot of trouble if Gluttony was still affecting him. When we got inside, my heart sank into my bowels. Bloody footprints on the tile floor leading to the door didn't bode well for Dracula's condition. The Van Helsing brothers kept their mouths shut. I was expecting an "I told you so" remark, but they held back. Dracula had been on the top of their slay list for centuries. I took off running down the hall, following the footprints to the old cafeteria. We had a heater that resembled a refrigerator. It kept our blood bottles at a healthy 98.6. The door was open. Several empty bottles littered the room.
"This isn't good," Dylan said.
I grunted and shook my head.
You think?
Alexander cleared his throat. I hate to say it, but if gluttony triggered Dracula's bloodthirst, we could have a much larger problem on our hands than we expected. If he drained your supply and left the schoolhouse, it can only mean one thing.
I clenched my fists. He went out looking for more blood.
Dylan scratched his head. I thought the demon couldn't affect supernaturals like that.
You're right, Reginald said. We might be dealing with more than one demon.
Alexander sat on the top of one of our cafeteria tables.
This is uncharted territory. It may be that multiple vices combined amplify one another. Imagine a little gluttony combined with envy or pride.
I'm not sure what that would look like, I admitted.
Dracula was the world's most feared vampire for years, Alexander mused. What if there's a small part of him that envies the freedom of other vampires to feed at will? Or if there's a kernel of villainous pride that makes him secretly wish he was still the world's most terrifying vampire?
I shook my head. I know Dracula. He's changed.
Has he? You've seen it like I have. He's been restless for weeks.
He regrets his past. He doesn't want to go back to it. Alexander looked hard at me.
Can you say with 100% confidence that there isn't any part of him at all that looks on his former status fondly? All it would take is a little nostalgia, and if pride or envy got a hold of him along with gluttony, it's not hard to imagine that he'd revert to his former nightmarish self.
I grunted. Even if that's the case, the influence should fade in a couple of days. If we can find him and restrain him for now, he should be fine. Right?
Alexander pressed his lips together.
Like I said before, we're in uncharted territory here. If multiple demons are exerting influence over Dracula, we can't assume anything. Even if the demon's influence fades, if he feeds like that, unrestrained for even a couple of days, there's no telling if he'll be able to come back from that. You've tasted blood from the source, Sienna. You've done well to resist the temptation, but Dracula hasn't ever had to suppress his urges that way.
That's not true. He hasn't fed on a human at all ever since he came with me to New Orleans.
Dylan put his hand on my back.
The reason Dracula was different was because he no longer embraced the dark power of the Scholomance. The Weird Sisters took that power from him. That's what's changed him. He didn't have to overcome his thirst for blood the way you did.
Whose side are you on? I huffed. This is Drac we're talking about.
You're right, Alexander said. It is Dracula we're talking about. You've never faced the old Dracula. Not like we have.
You're not like other vampires, Reginald reminded me.
From what we've learned of your past, you fought your urges for years and couldn't even access your vampiric abilities at night until recently. Even now, the only humans we know of you've bitten were hunters who threatened you or your werewolf friends.
I pressed my lips together. They weren't entirely correct. There was Leroy, the homeless man I sometimes paid for a bite. There were a couple of other times I fed as a daywalker, but only in the middle of a battle when I had little choice. I never attacked an innocent person.
You haven't lost control, Alexander stressed. That's remarkable. Dracula rarely exhibited much restraint at all. In Transylvania, he didn't stalk the streets. He didn't have to. He had other vampires, like the Weird Sisters, who brought him victims to satiate his thirst. If those urges have returned, and he no longer has minions willing to bring him his meals, and he's also under the influence of gluttony and possibly another demon or two, there's no telling what he might do. Especially now that you've changed him into a daywalker and he's free to go out in the day.
The demon must remain our priority, Father Albert put in. As terrifying as an unrestrained Dracula might be, he can only hurt one person at a time. Gluttony is destroying lives, murdering dozens of people, probably as we speak.
I paced between the cafeteria tables. Without Dracula, we don't have a lead that will help track down the demon. We still need to find him. When we do, let me talk to him. I can tuck him down.
I'm not sure we can risk that.
Alexander stood from the table and took me by the shoulders.
I know you're fond of the Dracula you think you know. If Dracula has reverted to his old self, though, you won't recognize him. He won't be the same vampire. We might not have a choice but to take him down.
We can restrain him. Give him enough time to see if he comes down from the demon's influence. He's still aligned with the power of light from the Scholomance. He can be saved again. I'm sure of it. Reginald grabbed his brother by the arm and pulled him aside.
Sienna is right about one thing. He might be our best chance at tracking down the demon. It's two birds with one stone. Catch Dracula, and we have a better...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.